As a student, I was wondering why the several books only give cofibration for an inclusion map, whereas fibration is for arbitrary map, not necessarily quotient map. The answer was in this result that we are going to do. But there is an even more satisfactory answer. Much, much later, only some 10 years back, I read it from Hatcher's book, that every cofibration is actually a inclusion map. So what are we going to do? Because we are studying things up to homotopy, in homotopy theory, this result says that, okay, any map can be replaced by inclusion map, and that inclusion map is a cofibration. So this was so powerful that now you can think of up to homotopy, every map is a cofibration. Okay. So this completely justifies the somewhat artificially introduced notion of cofibration. Okay. We are not claiming that every map is a cofibration, but up to homotopy, it is. So let us go through this one. So later on, we will see a lot of applications of this one. And so this itself is somewhat hard work you have to do now. So here is a statement. Given any map X to Y, let us construct the mapping cylinder MF. Okay. Remember, what was MF? MF was obtained as X cross I disjoint union Y by the identification, namely each X is identified with its image Fx. So I am making this diagram of various functions here. X is included in the MF, okay? There's a map X to Y, then MF to Y, there is an F at, and then Y is also included in MF by an inclusion map J, okay? So this F at is actually an extension of F, because X is thought of as a subspace of MF. Okay, so all these things I am writing down carefully, namely F hat composite J is F. That is, the first triangle is commutative, top triangle. Right? J composite F hat is a map from M to M, MF to MF, right? This map is homotopic to identity of MF. Okay, so the second diagram, second triangle here, the bottom triangle, is not a commutative triangle. It is homotopy commutative. It's homotopic to identity. Okay. A composite F hat is homotopic to identity. And this homotopy is relative to Y. That is, F hat is a strong deformation retraction of MF to Y. In particular, Y is a SDR of MF. MF union X cross I is a strong deformation retract of MF cross I. So I is a cofibration inclusion map. From C to D, you know how to go, because we have seen this one. J composite F, finally, it's J composite F coming from F to MF. Okay. ये कंपोजिट है, इट्स होमोटॉपिक टू द इंक्लूजन मैप इटसेल्फ, द टॉप थिंग. तो व्हेन यू पुट दिस एरो आइडेंटिटी, इफ यू डोंट पुट दिस वन, द डायग्राम इज कम्यूटेटिव. इफ यू पुट दिस वन, वट एवर रिजल्टिंग कम थिंग्स बिकम, दे विल बी होमोटॉपिक कम्यूटेटिव. इफ यू कम फ्रॉम हियर टू हियर एंड कम फ्रॉम हियर टू हियर, इट इज होमोटॉपिक, बिकॉज this is homotopic to the identity. This is precisely the last thing he says. J composite F is homotopic to the inclusion map I. This same thing is I composite identity. Okay, so let us prove one by one. More, some of them are completely obvious. Namely, the first thing, F hat composite I is F, we have already seen. What is F hat? What is F hat? Each point of FMF is a class x comma t, right? Or bracket y. X comma t or bracket y. Remember that these are equivalence classes of elements from x cross I union y. Right? If it's a y part, then y goes to y itself. If it is x comma t, take it to fx. Okay, so it is well defined, because whenever it's identified, namely x cross 1, at x cross 1, things are identified, but they are identified with fx only. So it makes sense. So it is an extension of f, which is defined on x cross 0, x cross 1, whatever. Okay, so first part we have already seen. Second one, so we have to define homotopy here. So take G1, X cross I to MF, G2 from Y cross I to MF, defined by G1 of X, T, S, X is as it is, you see. It is, everything is happening in I cross I. So that's the 1 minus S times T plus S. You join T and S, 1 minus S times T plus constant 1, you join by S. Okay, 1 minus T times S plus S times 1, the constant 1, that's the function. You are joining them. The first part is as it is. The second function, GYS, is just Y, ignores the S coordinate. These maps fit together and induce a homotopy from MF cross I to MF. On X cross I, when X equal to, when T equal to 1, it was identified with FX, right? If T is 1, this is just X comma S, right? And it is just Y. Okay, so these maps fit together, define MF cross I to MF. Okay, go down to the quotient spaces from identity of MF to J composite R. Okay, relative to Y, if Y is there, always it is just constant function. If the coordinate is Y, then it is just constant function. Okay, what is J composite R? Just see that. What is this R? What is this? Not correct now. J composite F hat it should be. Instead of that, I put J composite R. It's not correct. Okay. Identity of MS to J composite F hat. Okay. Relative to Y. For the proof of C, that MF union X cross I is a strong determinant of MF cross I. Okay, so what you have to do, just similar to what you have done. Okay, I have to recall that the construction that we have done, in module, previous module, this one, 20 or 2019, that whatever we have done. So let me go back to this 8 here, all the way this one. So this map will be again used. Okay? Exactly similar to that. So H1 is X cross I cross I cross I to MF cross I. H2 is Y cross I cross I to MF cross I. H1 of X T T double prime T double prime is X comma S. Similar to what we have done in the case of arbitrary X. That's precisely what we are doing here, exactly same way. S part is taken here, X part is undisturbed. H2 of Y, T prime T double prime is Y remains as it is, and we are ignoring T double prime here, 1 minus T prime, taking the reverse of that. If you do this, just like the same similar notation as in that one, all that you have to do is verify that they fit together. Fitting together means what? Y is a subspace of MF, right? So on that part, you have to verify that, okay, wherever this Y is instead of MF here, so X cross I, FX X cross 1 is identified as MX, so that is like Y. So there also you have to verify what happens to the map. So then they agree as a function. So then continuity follows because all these, whatever they agree, all those spaces are closed subspaces. So they fit together to define a map F H from MF cross I cross I. MF will be, this part, X cross I, disjoint union, Y cross I, one more I have taken. Then identification you have to verify. So it gives you a map from MF cross I cross I to MF cross I, which is a Tronc different with tract of MF cross I into MF union X cross I. Okay. So MF union F cross I is a differential tract of MF cross I. Once you have this, the proposition will tell you that the inclusion map of MF into MF cross I is a what? Sorry, in inclusion of X into MF is a cofibration. So that is D. D tells you that I is a cofibration. What is I? I is the inclusion map of X into MF. Okay. Finally, what is E? E is J composite F is homotopic to I. J composite F will be equal to J composite F hat composite I. Right? J composite F, composite J composite F hat composite I. Now, you have already shown that this composite, this is homotopic to identity. Therefore, the whole thing will be homotopic to identity, composite I, since it's same thing as homotopic to identity. So this follows easily from our these two, if you put these two things together. Okay, A and B together. Okay, so essence of this one, this is all this may be difficult to remember. What you have done? Start with F, any map, it's replaced by I, this inclusion map, okay. This F is getting replaced, go back to this one. This I is replaced by this one, okay, the inclusion map, it's homotopic to this one. As if it is homotopic to F. It's not exactly homotopic to F because things are not taking place here, but inside here. Okay, so J composite F is homotopic to I. So that is the meaning of that F is replaced by I inclusion map of topology. Okay. Instead of Y, we have MF. But what is the relation between MF and Y? They have the same homotopy type. They are homotopy equivalent. F hat is homotopy equivalence. In fact, this is not an ordinary homotopy equivalent. This is a strong deformational tract. Y is a strong deformational tract. Up to strong deformational tract, this F becomes I. We cannot define an inverse here, but the J plays the role of homotopy inverse. That's also same. So F composite J sits inside MF, map into MF, and that's homotopic to I. Okay, so that in that sense, that a arbitrary continuous function has been replaced by a inclusion map into some other space. And what is this space? This is homotopy type of the codomain. It is strong deformative tract. Codomain is strong deformative tract of that one. It contains a codomain also. It's an enlarged codomain of this map. F has some codomain Y. Now that Y we have enlarged. And the enlargement is does not lose the homotopy invariant. I mean, homotopy information is not lost. Okay. So this is the gist of the theorem, and essentially we use the construction of this number 8, namely going back all the way, of taking I cross I and constructing a strong deformational tract. That was the fundamental result in all these things. Thus, the mapping cylinder is a device that enables us to replace an arbitrary map F from X to Y by an inclusion map, which is a cofibration up to homotopy. Observe that MF contains lots of copies of X and a copy of Y. X cross I. So for each T, X cross T is there, except at X cross 1, there are identifications. Okay. From B of the above theorem, we have that Y is a strong deformative tract of MF. The mapping cone, there is a mapping cone construction, CF, is called the cofiber of the fibration. Okay, in the next section, we shall give a number of applications of the mapping cylinder. So, to sum up, the hard work is somewhat over now. So, next module, we will reap the harvest. Lot of interesting applications will be there now for this. Okay, so that's all. We will not continue now. We will stop here. So let us take the next thing later. Okay. So there are some exercises here. As usual, I will just go through a few of them, but I am not giving you any solution as such. The first thing is you should know all these things. These are all more or less point set topological thing. Given any two points in the interior of the disk, there is a homeomorphism F from Dn to Dn such that Fp goes to Q. P and Q are both interior points. On the boundary, F is identity. The boundary is undisturbed. Any point goes to any point. First, prove this one for a closed interval. A and B fixed, give me a homeomorphism which takes any point strictly inside AB to another point, and it must be homeomorphism. Okay, I think you should be able to do this. So for all disks, you must be able to do this. So for the once you do it for unit disk, it will be done for all unit disks in all R. Okay, next thing is, how far are these convex subsets related to the standard convex set, namely a bar? Let us look at that one. Let X be a convex polygon inside Rn, inside R2, with n vertices, n greater than equal to 3. A convex polygon, like a triangle or a quadrilateral and so on. Okay, I am not assuming any regularity here, any convex polygon. Okay, show that X is homeomorphic to the cone over the boundary of X. Boundary of X is a, you know, when you say triangle, there is some confusion. The full triangle or the boundary triangle. Okay, so here I mean convex polygon, I mean the entire convex hull of the whole thing. And the boundary, it consists of only sides of the polygon, right? So on the boundary, that's a topological space, you take the cone over that, then you have to show that that cone is homeomorphic to the convex polygon itself. Okay, the full triangle is homeomorphic, the cone over the triangle. Okay, so that is the first exercise here. Now choose any n distinct points A1, A2, An on the standard circle. Okay. Now construct a homeomorphism F from the boundary of this polygon to S1 so that the vertices of X, X has n vertices, are mapped into A1, A2, An. Here you will have to you'll be forced to take the A1, A2, An in a particular order. Namely, whichever way, suppose V1, V2, Vn are the vertices of the polygon, written in a particular order consecutively, then A1, A2, An must be also consecutive. Okay, you can shuffle them. You cannot shuffle them. So that is understood here. So V1 should go to A1, V2 should go to A2, Vn should go to An, and the entire thing must be a homeomorphism of the boundary of X to S1. Okay. Next, construct a homeomorphism G from X to D2, which is the interior of S1 together, which extends the given F in B. Okay, that must be extension on the boundary, it must be your F, and the whole thing must be a homeomorphism G. Do the same thing as in B and C with the right half disk G, with three of the points on the boundary being 0, 1, 0, 0, and 0, minus 1. So I'm taking half disk here inside D2, inside R2. Instead of taking a convex polygon, I am taking another convex set. The half disk is also convex set. Okay. Its boundary consists of a line segment on the y-axis, namely minus 1 to 1, and half circle on the left. Okay, on the right. Right half disk you are taking. So take 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, these three points. Okay. Map them to three distinct points on the circle. Construct a homeomorphism on the boundary and then construct a homeomorphism of the half disk to the full disk. So that's what you have to do in D. Okay. Similarly, now this exercise. Assume that n is greater than or equal to 4 now. Okay, at least 4 points. Let A1, A2, A3 be three consecutive sides, consecutive vertices of X, sorry, and vertices of X. Y be the quotient space of X obtained by identifying the points of the edge A1 to A2, then A3 to A2, reverse order. To identify them by the rule, t times a2 plus 1 times 1 minus t times a1, that will lie on the edge a1 a2, right? Should be identified to t times a2 plus 1 minus t times a3. In other words, a2 will remain as is. a1 and a3 are get identified. So this is the only identification. The two edges are identified. Okay. So for all t less than equal to t1, you make this identification. Whatever you get, the entire convex polygon, okay, after identification, again is homeomorphic to D2. Okay, for this you have to assume that there are more vertices. So like this, there are other exercises also here. Then over the cones, okay. So later on, these are on loops and homotopies of the maps and so on. So this is on our first part of the thing. So this one we have already used. If X is Hausdorff space, the inclusion map is a cofibration, then A is a closed subspace. I have indicated the proof already. So you can just write down by memory if you have understood it, or you have to work it out yourself. Okay. So this also I have indicated, namely phi 1 of XA can be identified with homotopy classes of loops from S1 to, I mean, continuous functions from S1 to X, where 1 goes to A. And the homotopy classes here are keeping 1 fixed throughout the homotopy. So that is the meaning of phi 1 of XA. This has been already used. Okay. So you write down a detailed proof of that one. Now, suppose you have a map which is null homotopy defined on the circle. Then phi 1 of xx naught is trivial for each point x naught belonging to S1. What I'm saying, take any loop in X, suppose it's null homotopy. If any loop in X is null homotopy, then phi 1 of xx naught is trivial for each point of X. Okay. No matter where it is. This should be true for all loops. So this is a straightforward application of this exercise. So if you have a path connected space, okay, the just homotopy classes without any base points, okay, free homotopy classes is equal to the set of conjugacy classes of elements in phi 1 of xx naught. Phi 1 of xx naught is a group. In a group, you know what is the meaning of conjugacy classes. That's what you have to show, that conjugacy classes are in one-on-one correspondence with homotopy classes of maps from S1 to X. Base points are not fixed here. So that is the difference. Okay. From this, you can deduce this theorem, this exercise also. This exercise, actually, I have solved it in the theory part itself, roughly. I have given you sufficient hint, so this is easy to work out for you. As a path connected space, if phi 1 of xA is abelian, if and only if, what happens? For each b inside X, for all paths from tau from A to B, the H tau, which is obtained by conjugating by the path tau, phi 1 of xA to phi 1 of xB, this map, which is are the same, that from all maps, whatever tau, for all paths tau, H tau is the same map, same homomorphism, same bijection, whatever you. This is an exercise which will help you to prove that the comb space, in the comb space, 1, 0 is not a strong deformation retract. First prove this exercise. 4.11. What does it say? Suppose some point is a strong deformation retract. Then for every open subset U of X containing X naught, that means every neighborhood of X naught, there is another neighborhood V inside X naught, inside V, inside U, the neighborhood of X naught inside U, such that inclusion map U to V is null homotopic in V. U to V, you can write a homotopy to a constant function. That's the meaning of that. Starting with an inclusion map to a constant function, there is homotopy. If you use this cleverly, then you can show that 0, 1 is not a SDR of the comp space. No hand waving. Okay, for that I have already told you what you have to use is the comb space is not locally path connected or locally connected. At each point on the y-axis, it fails to be locally path connected. Use that, use this exercise, you can complete the proof of this SDR. Okay. So let us stop here. So next time we will see many more results. So as I told you, hard work is more or less over for a while. Okay. Thank you.